had a border collie named Lucy, and I used to dress her up all the time. And we were dancing around one time. I had rhinestones all over, and we were dancing around going, Lucy in disguise with diamonds. And I don't know, it just stuck in my head. Of course, I stole it from the Beatles, you know. And I stole Electric Ladyland from Jimi Hendrix. But if you're going to steal, steal from the best.
Picture yourself in a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies. Somebody calls you, you answer quite slowly. A girl with kaleidoscope eyes.
Let's see, I moved to Austin because I'd searched everywhere for the perfect place to live. And it ended up being back where I came from, or you know, I didn't come from Austin, but I came from Texas. I thought it would have an ocean, the perfect place to live, but it didn't. So that was a trick.
Oh, this is by far the largest costume shop I've ever seen in my life. And I mean, I travel a lot. I've been to costume shops in New York and London and all of that, and I've never seen anything that comes close.
I think a big part of that is Austin and its whole keep Austin weird mentality. Right. But we have so many tourists, and every tourist that comes in is like, we need one of these in our town. Like, I always hear that, you know? And so I really feel like just any big city could use something like this. You know, I don't think it's just because it's Austin and just because we're kind of a unique kind of people, but I just think other places just don't have this kind of place. If they did, it probably would get used a lot.
I have always been addicted to clothes and costumes. I mean, back when I had no reason to be buying that many, I couldn't have possibly worn them in a million years. I was living in California, and Cher gave her wardrobe to the SPCA thrift store, and I spent all my money buying it up. You know, it was like, that was just a one time, you know, one wardrobe. She had many, but yeah. Anyway, I've just always bought that stuff just because I love it. That's my treasure. And I stored it, and I had to have bigger and bigger houses and bigger storerooms, and stored it until they were going to commit me if I didn't do something else with it. I didn't want anybody to buy it or even touch it, really. But had to do this, and that was back 23 years ago.
Wow.
So I've just continued, and now I have a reason. Now I have credibility. You know, it's like before I was just like, people would say, what are you going to do with all this stuff? And I'd just say, is that any of your business?
Yeah.
You know, but now it's like, oh, she's buying it for that costume store. Little do these people know that it's going to go to my closet first, probably, and then finally I'll let it go.
We get all walks of life in here. I mean, for Carnival, you know, we have like a 80-year-old woman who wants like pasties and a wig to wear out, you know, and then, you know, later we'll have a lawyer who needs a giant bunny suit. Like, it's very just sporadic and fun.
A majority of them are adults, so we don't really have many children. A lot of them are UT students.
UT's our biggest customer, of course. All the sororities and fraternities.
Yeah.
Who knew?
Also, there's a surprising number of corporate events that they decide to do themed. So they'll decide to have an 80s prom. So it'll be all these people that work in a building downtown that come in, and they've never seen anything like this before. And those kind of people really need our help more than people who come in who are young and already have that creative vibe to them. So
they're working it.
Awesome. I have to be Mr. Spock.
Oh, really? For what?
For a thing for my work.
Oh, nice.
I have to be a Southern Belle for a school project, and it's really perfect. They have like a whole section.
She said that she needed a nun outfit, so I brought her to the back and took her to the religious section and said, here they are, and I left her, and then I went back to check on her, and she had a habit on, and she was like brushing her head like this, and she said, it's okay, I'm back here, it's okay. And I said, are you all right? And she said, it's just a religious experience. It kind of scares me. I'm kind of frightened back here. And I said, well, let's take you out here, you know, into the other area. And I you know, showed her some of the other costumes, and then she said, I think I'm ready. I'm ready for you to take me back. I'm ready to experience it again. And I was like, I don't think you're ready.
Places, request. Well, our giant vagina was an odd one at first, but then, you know, after frat boys asked for that a few times, it doesn't seem so crazy anymore. But yeah, that was the first one that shocked me, and what shocked me even more is that we had the costume.
Children have walked to the party room before, and there's masks, and I wasn't here that day, but one little girl walked up and saw the masks and just peed all over the floor. I mean, kids get so frightened at that. A lot of kids just start crying the second that they see the masks.
I make my own patterns, and there's times where they'll tell me I need a Renaissance dress in burgundy, or I need a French fry costume. But generally, I sit up there in the workshop, and I'm surrounded by fabric, and just kind of get inspired by the fabrics. I see a certain fabric I want to work with, and then I design a dress around this particular fabric. But regardless of what I'm doing, I sew extremely fast. So the design part takes much longer than actual physical construction. Because I have to, since I'm making patterns in my mind, I'm trying to figure out how these flat pieces fit together to make a three-dimensional form. So that's the hard part. By the time you get down to sitting to the sewing machine, you're practically done. What this machine is actually doing is trimming off the raw edge. I'm creating a finished seam at the same time.
I see.
Does all of that in one step.
It's amazing.
And then you have a fur hat, which I'm going to put ears on, and it's probably going to be a teddy bear.
It's not that you lose the excitement, it's just that, like, on the holidays that people tend to dress up for example, Halloween, I've been working 12-hour days, 6 days a week. And so, you know, the last thing I want to do is get dressed up and go out. I just go home and go to bed.
Like, I used to go out on Halloween night, and I'd put together this elaborate costume, and we'd go to find out when the judgings were at all the different bars and how much money it was and when the times were and be there. And I've made, like, up to $5,000 one judging night. And now I just go to bed.
And that's a shame, because before working here, I was, like, into the goth scene forever and just dressed up for any reason, any time. But being surrounded by this all the time, I don't even have the desire to dress up anymore. And that really sucks, because I enjoy that so much, and it's kind of gone now.
We're in a time where over the top, as far as style, has become a bad word. You know, I mean, how many times on the red carpet do you have, it's a bit over the top. I hate that. If the top is what you strive for, isn't it? So, you know, if you go over it, you should get the prize, right?